So thank you, Peg, for having us back. I mean, much better weather this time than what we would have had last time, so I'm really glad. I'm really honored to be in this group. I'm going to be reading from the Duel for Consuelo, which is not listed in your programs because of the timing of all of this. And it's the second book in my Castillo trilogy. And a little bit of introduction. Everybody's heard of the Spanish Inquisition? Nobody expected Spanish. But a lot of people don't know that in Mexico in the colonial era, there was a fully operating arm of the Inquisition there too. And my book takes place in Mexico in 1711, and it's the story of two women, Consuelo and her mother, caught in the web of the Inquisition for being secret Jews, or crypto-Jews. It's also a love story, and a story of family and the power of secrets. I'm going to give you a little bit of an introduction before I read, though, because the part I'm reading, to comply with the theme of sweet, comes on page 178, so I'm going to do a little bit. Those who converted to Christianity at the point of a sword and their descendants were fiercely persecuted by the Inquisition. Any hint of Judaizing or secretly practicing their old religion was ruthlessly ferreted out, which led the conversos to the practice of haciendo sábado, which is doing the Sabbath, and putting on overt displays of Christianity for their neighbors. Nonetheless, many continued their Jewish practices in secret. Mexico was something of a haven for the crypto-Jews at first. With so much novelty there, there was less time to spend ferreting out Jews and more emphasis on political alignment, heresy, and bigamy. But in 1642, in an auto de fe, hundreds of crypto-Jews were persecuted, the estates of those convicted were confiscated, and a few were burned at the stake. After 1650, the presence of crypto-Jews essentially withered in Mexico. Where there had once been an extensive system of safe houses and patronage, these broke up and the remaining Judaizers were on their own. Some Jews knew only one blessing. Many knew no Hebrew at all. Knowledge was passed down in the family, sort of in a telephone game. With each generation, the practices became more idiosyncratic, further and further removed from their origins. So the Duel for Consuelo picks up right at this point. In this scene, Consuelo approaches one of the few remaining safe houses where she'll rest before trying to rescue her mother. Bless you. She's been given a series of statements to make as passwords, but they ring strange in her ears as she tries to gain access. The knocker was unadorned and no name was engraved upon it, but it was well affixed to the door. To the left of the door was a lamp, unlit in the early morning and hidden behind it, only vaguely discernible to Consuelo, thanks to her height, was a small oblong box. A memory rose unbidden of a similar box with a roll of parchment within on the door to her grandmother Rosa's home. Bless this house. What a terrible risk this family was taking, she thought. But there was no longer a doubt that she had come to the right place. She only hoped they believed her. The sound of the knocker echoed in her head in the dawn quiet. She waited. Heart pounding, she raised the knocker once again, letting it fall from her clammy hand. Just as it fell, the door opened a hand's breadth, and a small girl looked up at her. Her eyes were wide and brown, and her skin was the color of honey. She peered around the door, and Consuelo could see her blue sleeping dress and bare feet. ¿Qué quieres? What do you want? Marcela, came a woman's voice from within. Come back here. The little girl slammed the door shut. For several moments, Consuelo waited, wondering if she should knock again. But the door opened, and this time a woman, only slightly older than Consuelo, appeared. She had the same eyes and honey skin as the little girl. Yes? Good morning? It was an awkward greeting, barely covering the unspoken question so simply phrased by the child. Good morning, Consuelo said. Forgive me for waking the household so early. She could smell meat and chocolate and something else, sweet and enticing. Her stomach growled and she blushed. She had not eaten since her miserable bites of Good Friday rations. We are awake, the woman replied, still holding the door to the width of her body. Is this the house of Don Juan de Leon? The woman nodded. Consuelo swallowed. The next sentence would doom or save her. I am a woman with a good heart and I seek his advice. She tagged on the second part as the first seemed too odd to leave hanging. The woman's eyebrows shot up. Indeed. Consuelo felt her brow tighten. I am not a beggar. I try to be a good person. The woman smiled slightly and opened the door wider. Come in. Consuelo entered the foyer and the woman shut and locked the door behind her. What's your name? Marieta Consuelo Costa Argenta. Señorita Costa, welcome. Granddaughter of Rosa and Emilio Argenta. The smile on the woman's face was genuine. You knew my grandparents? I never met my grandfather. He was dead long before I was born. But my grandmother Rosa lived until I was 10. I am Susana Perez de Leon, and Juan de Leon is my father-in-law. You met my daughter, Marcela. I did know your grandmother, though only briefly. My father-in-law knew her well. And your mother, Layla, right? Consuelo nodded, surprised. Yes, my father-in-law knew her too. Is she still living? Barely, Consuelo answered quietly. Susana nodded. Well, if that's your card, you must bring it around to the back of the house and tie your horse up in the back in the courtyard. We cannot have it out front, and no one in our household is available to help you. Consuelo looked around at the fine furnishings. The room she had been led to had the long, high windows of a city home and a rich, thick rug on the floor. The drapes, in similar red and gold tones as the rug, hung heavily next to the windows, and the seats in gold and green leather were amply padded. How was it that no servant had answered the door? No groom was able to stable her horse, and yet they could live in such sumptuous surroundings. Susana watched her closely. You don't know, do you? I'm not sure if I do or I do not. Susana raised her eyebrows again, and Consuelo felt her heart skip. She had answered wrong, missing the cue. At least you're honest, Susana said at last. It's the Sabbath. We do not work on the Sabbath. And we dismiss our servants for the day so they cannot be held to that knowledge. You do not keep the Sabbath holy, I take it? I do nothing overtly, and only lit the candles for my mother when she asked, but it is for her that I'm here. Well, it's late enough that the neighbors are about and will suspect that the lady of quality is seen stabling her own horse. I will call my husband. A mission of mercy trumps the careful observance of law. Thank you, she said to Susana's retreating form. When she returned, she had a tray with cups, pastries, and an oyer of chocolate. I will not serve you, so help yourself. Consuelo took a cup from the tray and poured chocolate from the rustic corral. She smelled the cinnamon and spice fragrance and sipped gratefully at the thick brown liquid. She reached for a pastry. Dip it in the syrup, Susana said. It has honey and lemon and mint to soothe your nerves. The sweet pastry had been fried in oil and was crisp on the outside, with a meltingly creamy interior center. The sweet syrup made for a rich confection, and Consuelo took another. Susana nodded, then turned her head as two men entered the room. Then she stood up and looked meaningfully at Consuelo. Still holding the dripping pastry, Consuelo rose. The men did not bow or acknowledge her. The older man with a gray pointed beard and short hair looked at Susana. Is this she? Yes, Father, Susana said. She is Consuelo Costa Argenta, daughter of Layla, granddaughter of Rosa. Consuelo, she added, turning to her, this is Don Juan de Leon and my husband, his son, Jose Luis. Jose Luis was thin and also wore a beard. His was black with one or two streaks of gray beginning to show. He glanced quickly at her, and Consuelo thought she saw amusement and intelligence in his gray eyes before he looked back at his father. Neither man looked at her directly. What does she want? Shelter, it seems, and something more. We were just getting to it. If you please, Consuelo began. Susana raised her hand to stop her. They will not address a strange woman unless they are certain that she is not unclean. Consuelo blushed and shook her head. I will see to her comfort, Father, but you and Jose Luis must inquire of her mission. Don Juan cocked his head. Are you in command? Susana shrugged. I just think it would be more efficient if those who can help her hear it from the person who needs it. Don Juan turned to his son. See to it that Señorita Costa is given whatever she needs. Susana, I will go to my study now. Certainly, Father, you will not be disturbed. Don Juan turned and left the room without once acknowledging Consuelo. He is the keeper of our people's knowledge, Susana said, sitting down again. He has received a traveling rabbi, and now must learn and remember everything he was taught so as to teach it to us all. We are apparently very ignorant in our language and customs. Our prayers are wrong from so much time away from any source, and our habits shoddy and imprecise. Her voice held a trace of surprising bitterness. My wife is not guarded in her speech, José Luis said, sitting down as well. Consuelo followed suit. But she has learned at a level that I cannot hope to achieve, and so is permitted a loose tongue. If I am not to be learned, who will teach our daughter? And if we have no sons, who will carry the words of the rabbis forward, if not she? And if she does not teach her children, who will?